hoping that you will get what they done put in the book. They don't want to spend no time with your soul. And as I was sharing with them in the Sunday school, it grieves me, and I know it bothers God, to be able to see the ones that said I've been called by God, but yet I'm not doing what God told me to do for his people.
Amen.
See, I've been called by God, and you know, and I'm Reverend so-and-so, and I'm Apostle such-and-such, and I'm Evangelist this, and I'm Prophetess this and that and stuff, and you know, and you got to make the way for me, and I got all this entourage with me and stuff like that, but I'm not concerned about your soul. I'm only concerned about what I look like. I'm only concerned about how much I can get for myself and what I can get out of you.
That's right.
And then I'm going to pat you on the shoulder and I'm going to say, well, God loves you. That's about the most anointed word that you're going to get from a lot of them. God loves you. Well, you already knew that.
That's right.
Amen.
That's your prophetic word right there. But you already knew that.
Amen.
So we're going to talk to you a few minutes today about living a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. Because see, everything that appears to be is not what is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Everything that we see on that TV screen about how famous these people are, if you want to use that word, or how the stars are this and they that. Who in the world named people stars? Who in the world has classified people and set them off like they are just like God?
Celebrities.
Who done that? God didn't do that.
Amen.
Because he don't have no respect of a person.
That's right. That's right.
He don't have nobody. He done put on no high pedestal above nobody else and looking down at them.
That's right.
He the only somebody that sits high and earth is his footstool and he looks down.
Amen.
Why? Because he's God and he can do that.
Amen.
But
Amen.
See, the ones that are doing that, they're looking down on God.
Amen.
Oh yeah, they're looking down on him. And again, that's that ambitious pride that's telling God, I'm God too. Look at how the people are flocking to me. Look how the people are making all over me. You hear them chanting my name. You hear them. You see the lights got my name all up in it. You got people now, the gospel has become, since Jasmine always says I make up words, but I'm going to have to say this, celebritized. It might not be no word, but you know, I'm going to throw it out there. Webster can use it if he wants to. Celebritized. You got the word of God, but these people out here now, they are so concerned about how they look and how they sound and what they how they going to step out in front of you and all that, and holding their Bible and they pad, their iPad. I'm old school. I don't do the iPad yet because I don't trust the transmissions in the air. So see, I know that the prince of the air, I know who he is. Okay? So ain't no need of me spending no money on an iPad, and I walk in a building and that thing ain't gonna come on and I'm steady. If I get this book right here and begin to turn these pages, it's already written. Ain't nothing gonna go out on this book.
Amen.
That's why I tell people, it's okay if you ain't got no Bible and you don't practice no Bible, but you need to practice one, because ain't no anointing in your phone.
Amen.
Ain't no anointing in them iPads. Ain't no anointing in that stuff. But the way you read it is the way you read it.
Amen.
And you ain't gonna get nothing out of that. But when you get that Holy Bible in your hand and you begin to get in a quiet place and you begin to meditate on God's word and you begin to love on his word, because see, he knows when you love his word by the way you study. Come on now, come on. See, the way you study it tells God, I'm in love with you. See, the way you even turn the pages tells God how intimate you are with him. I'm telling you. So see, on that phone, is the Wi-Fi working? My heart is in this. See, my heart is in this. I can put my heart in this with this word of God, is what I'm saying. Because see, like I said, you can't get nothing out of them other ones. You know, like I said, you liable to lose connection at any point in time, which means you just lost connection with the Lord.
Right,
isn't that something? You just lost connection with him. Why? Because the Wi-Fi just acting up right now. the prince of this air. You do know who the prince of this air is, right?
Amen.
Amen. You do know, right? He even owned the air. I'm telling you. And then the systems of this world charge us for the air.
Yeah.
You check out the house that you own. I guarantee you so many feet up in the air, they have charged you for that air over your house. Mm-hmm. And how they can do that, I'll never know, but they do. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling you, we got to live a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. Well, let's look at 1 Peter 1. Verses 14 through 16. 1 Peter 1. Don't be afraid now if you got your phone. Go ahead and get your stuff. You know, I'm just saying, okay?
I'll bring this here.
Amen. Amen. But I'm just saying, you know, this is just me because, like I said, when we do, seriously though, when you read the Word of God and study God's Word, you put your heart in it. You put what's in you in it. You know what I'm saying? And then when you put what's in you, I said 1 Peter.
Okay, amen. Thank you, Lord.
1 Peter. Chapter 1, verses 14 through 16. Okay. And see, and how do you ever know how much love you have for God is how you handle His Word.
Right now.
Isn't that something? Amen. You will always Amen. Know how much you really respect God because of the way you handle His Word. The way you live His Word. The way you carry that Word in you. Mm-hmm. The way you want to take that Word and put it out. So that's how you know really how much you love God. You really do. Because he just don't, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It ain't looking. And every time you pick this up, you got to go get the dust and stuff off of it because you ain't held this in your hand in so long. But you say, I love you, Lord. Ain't I love you? I love you, Lord.
You
know, my apostle used to always tell us that you can tell the level of surrenderance in a person from the way they lift their hands. Because see, lifting up your arms is a symbol of lifting up your heart. Mm-hmm. And how high you lift them up,
Lord.
Come on now, yeah. How high you lift them up tells God how much of your heart you gonna give Him. Amen. But when you like this, you know what that means, right? And some people don't even go up like this, they go like this. I ain't trying to give you a whole lot of nothing, God. But that's what it says. It has a meaning. Everything that we do have a meaning. And the thing is, we just have to, when it comes down to God and His Word, we've got to be very mindful of how we treat Him. Because, see, we want Him to move on our behalf.
Amen.
We want Him to be God. We want Him to be all of this that He said He is to me, to you. We want Him to do that. But yet still, I know that scripture here somewhere, and I can't find it nowhere. But anyway, you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna blog and just stop it with that. Like, we got to, my apostle used to always say, you got to turn the pages a certain way. You just can't handle God's word any kind of way.
Amen.
Because if you handle it any kind of way, that means that's the way you're handling it inside of you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Mm. If you're gonna be a vessel to carry the word, carry the word. And don't carry it with pride, but carry it with humility.
Amen.
Carry it in meekness. Carry it in with the fruit of the Spirit, in other words. Mm-hmm. Don't just carry God's word any kind of way. Mm-hmm. That's part of our lifestyle.
Jesus.
That's my lifestyle. You got to know, living a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. Okay, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 14 through 16 reads, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust of your ignorance. See, the Bible tells us we were ignorant in sin. It tells us up front that you was ignorant and you was in sin. You was in the lust of your sin.
Amen.
So ain't no need to get mad at the word, because the word said it. I didn't say it, the word said it.
Amen.
Verse 15 says, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. You mean to tell me I got to be holy in conversation?
Amen.
I can't joke and jest and just say, thank you, Lord. After I done cussed and lied and chewed all kind of bits in my mouth, and then I'll go hallelujah. You mean to tell me I can't do all that? Mm. Not be holy. Mm-mm. Not be holy. See, people think holiness, tradition and religion has lied to us. They make us think holiness is a way of dressing the outward man. Mm-hmm. Holiness is where your heart sits at, between you and God and His word in obedience.
Amen.
That's what holiness is. Holiness is being able to communicate in relationship with the Creator, with the Creator God, the one that made you, the one that gave you breath this morning. Amen. The one that you should have gratitude constantly toward Him. Because you know, without breathing, without this breath, you wouldn't make it.
Amen.
Gratitude.
Amen.
Verse 16 says, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. People says, a lot of people said, you can't be holy living in no world like this. I beg to differ.
Amen. Amen.
I do. I beg to differ. And then, see, you got to, again, you got to know your relationship with God. You got to know where the word is in you and how that word will stand up on your behalf. Because you got people out here that will criticize you and tell you, you ain't holy. I remember when you was a strumpet on the street. I remember when you was doing such and such.
Amen.
But you got to know the word, because the word says that any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. Bible says, behold, that means look, look, look. Mm-hmm. All things have become new. Amen. So the thing is, you got to know you are a new creature, because if not, this world will tear you down.
Amen.
And the people of the world, because everybody is saying, oh, I love Jesus. Oh, now their favorite thing is, I know God. Okay. That's a red flag right there. When the Bible teaches us in St. John 6:44, it says, no man cometh to the Father except he be drawn. And then you got to come through Jesus. Mm-hmm. Can't go there. You ain't going there. Oh, I know God. Yeah, well, okay, everybody know God.
Right.
To the point of creating heaven and earth. Everything we see, that's God.
Mm-hmm.
But see, we don't want to mess with God, because see, God sees sin.
Yes.
God sees our ignorance.
Amen.
That's why you don't want to mess with God until you put on that new creature called Jesus Christ. Because see, trying to deal with God without Jesus is just like putting yourself in front of a firing squad.
Yes, yes.
So you're getting ready to die. If you ever have access to Him without Jesus shielding you, you are dead.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, remember the Ark of the Covenant?
Mm-hmm.
You remember how they couldn't even come near that Ark of the Covenant because of the holiness of it? And they had to have these rods on it so far on each side. And when they carried up on. And one day, I think in one of the stories in the Bible, it looked like it was tilted over and about to fall. And somebody ran up there to try to grab it, and the thing just killed them. Why? Because of the holiness of it. God, I love you, Jesus. Because of the spirit that reside in it. That's why we can't treat God any kind of way. Because see, and that's why Jesus came. He sent His Son Jesus to shield us, to bring us back into right standing with Him, reconciling us back to Him, put on a new creature, Jesus Christ Himself.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Lord God.
Jesus. He says, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy.
Amen.
Okay, God's holiness is required, and without His Spirit, it's hard to be holy. Oh yeah, it's hard to be holy without His Spirit, because see, His Spirit in you requires holiness to Himself.
Amen.
I'm gonna let you see that.
Amen.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna let you see that. You have to see that thing. Because see, when He puts Himself in us, it is to glorify Him.
Amen.
It ain't for us to walk around and say, oh yeah, I got the Holy Ghost. I'm full of Jesus. I got it. When He gives us His Spirit and His Spirit possesses us, it is to God be the glory, because He's doing it for Himself. That's why when you get weak in this flesh of yours, that's why He can stand up on the inside of you and begin to take you through what it is you're going through. Why? Because He has possession.
Amen.
But that comes with the lifestyle. It comes with a lifestyle of being able to live a lifestyle that will activate the promises.
Jesus.
The promises ain't nothing but the word of God and whatever else He has added to you. Because see, don't think that what God, when God speaks, this backs Him up.
Oh, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
This backs Him up. When God speaks to you, now just because I may not come to you with every eye that said in the word the way the word said, but whatever I share with you about healing, healing is the children's bread. It's in the book.
That's right.
And God honors that. Okay? So therefore, but there's times when he speaks words to you that are off of these pages, but he'll use other people to speak those words to you. And you have to have faith to activate that word in believing that word. Because see, without the faith, when you hear the word, without the faith, that word that you've spoken to you ain't going to do nothing.
That's right.
And 9 times out of 10, if you didn't have faith, you didn't hear it either. Because the Bible says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So when God speaks a word of encouragement to you, he knows what he's doing. He knows how to send the word to you. He knows when to send the word to you. But the thing is, we have to have the faith. Faith is part of our lifestyle. It is a lifestyle.
Amen.
He told Abraham to come out from amongst his kindred. Mm-hmm. He told him and separate yourself from them.
That's right.
Amen. And then Abraham, the father of faith, left us an inheritance here.
Mm-hmm.
That we too will be able to say to God, I just believe God.
Amen. Amen.
I just believe God. People ask me about this place. They say, well, how many members you got? I said, probably about 5, 6, or 7. I said, whoever else, I said, who knows? Whoever else gonna show up too.
Amen.
I said, but the thing is, God is doing this, not me. He said, I'm gonna do it.
My Lord.
He's already said, I've told the souls to come. I've released them, he said, to come. So now, all I'm doing is seeing the place filled. All I'm doing is watching the door open.
Uh-huh.
That's it.
By faith.
And I believe God. Because see, God can't lie.
My Lord.
He can't lie. Because see, when I gave up the military in 1994 for him, the first thing I said to him, I said, I'm going to watch your word and make sure you honor your word toward me. He could have knocked me out then from saying it like that. But he didn't. And I guess God was saying, well, I'm going to challenge that what you said. I'm going to call that thing what you said. Because I'm going to show you I am God. I'm going to show you I'm great in whatever I do and say. I'm going to show you I don't make no mistakes.
Glory.
God knows how to do it. Jesus.
Glory to God.
Thank you.
I'm going to show you who I am.
Glory to God.
That's the promise, you see. Because the lifestyle that we begin to live when we got saved begin to activate. The promises of God. Causes God to have. See, you have to be able to live in such a manner that you will cause God to begin to react before you even ask.
Glory to God.
Glory to God.
Glory.
That's a lifestyle in Him. See, when you can cause Him to move without you even having to do nothing. Why? Because you're living a life called righteousness and holiness in His sight.
Mm-hmm.
Not man's, God's.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Not mankind. Obedience. Those are things that God loves. Humility. Humbling yourself.
Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Living a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. Amen.
Amen.
I ain't gonna get through. And I didn't have but a little bit today, and I ain't gonna get through all that either. But amen. But I do believe that what's on here, I'm telling you. That's all I can do is believe that. Amen. Because see, when God gives me the word, He tells me to write, and I write. But I'm not a reader off the paper. I can't read it directly off the paper because it'll throw me. It'll throw me off. And whenever I hear the Lord, you know, in thought, then if I'm reading, I'll miss that thought.
Yeah, okay.
And I don't want to miss that thought. Because it'll bring me, usually brings me right back around to what's already here.
Amen.
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 Amen. So the word lifestyle is the way in which a person or a group lives. Simple as that. It's how we live. But God has a way that He calls a lifestyle in Him that He wants us to live. And it lines up with His word.
Amen.
And if we don't live according to the word of God down here, how do you expect to live in eternity with Him?
Amen.
You can't do it. Can't do it.
Amen.
If you're going to live any kind of way down here and you think the word of God is going to support you, just go, you know Psalms 23. Y'all don't make me laugh. Just go, you know Psalms 23, but you ain't living Psalms 23.
All right.
You ain't going nowhere with God because of that.
Amen.
You don't care nothing about how much you can memorize His word. The word has to be in your heart, and when it's in the heart, you got to live it. You got to act it out. You got to walk it out. Because see, that word, once that word gets in you, the word, that's how it transforms.
Yes.
That's how the word transforms. How? Because when I get it in my heart and I believe it by faith, I begin to move in what I know. Because it begins to transform me as I begin to operate in it day by day. Because see, once it gets in your spirit, there's no taking it out.
Jesus.
Oh no, it's no taking it out. That's why I can't understand how people can override the Holy Ghost.
Mm.
Once that word gets in your spirit and the Holy Ghost is on board and he gets that word, the Lord is just like this. Ain't no devil in hell gonna move me. It's my property.
Amen.
It's my property. This property belongs to me. And God takes his stand in it. That's why I know you cannot override God.
Glory,
God, I hear you, Jesus. Amen. Anybody that's able, any leader, any believer that's able to override God in your spirit, you better check that God that you said is in you.
Hello.
Because it might not be the Holy Ghost God that we know.
Amen. Amen.
Because when he comes in and he takes possession, he takes over.
My Lord.
You belong to him. You no longer belong to the world.
Amen.
Yet those things that you have once knew, he's processing you every day to get rid of it.
My
you
Lord.
Ain't even got to get rid of it. He'll get rid of it. Why? Because he's on board.
Jesus. Amen.
He don't live in a vessel that's got anything going on. He don't do that. Romans 14, verses 17 through 18 says, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. For he that in these things serveth Christ is acceptable to God and approved of men." Because see, when God gives you favor with him, you automatically get it with mankind.
Amen.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
Isn't that something? You ain't even got all that working hard you've been doing to try to convince somebody that you saved.
Yes.
You ain't even got to do
yes.
that. All you got to do is get favor with God. Because God is in charge of the creation. So therefore, when God gives you favor with him, he gives you favor with all mankind also.
Amen.
And he begins to open up doors for you. Why? Because that's a lifestyle.
Thank you, God.
That God appreciates. That's a lifestyle that pleases him.
Mm-hmm.
And see, we need to work on pleasing him. Because see, he says without faith, it's impossible to please him.
Amen.
And then
Amen.
He also said that he'll send his word out to do what he wants it to do. But that little fine part that says, as it pleases him. So when we send the word out, don't think you're going to send God's word out to do something that you want it to do.
Right.
It has to please God.
That's right.
God, I love you, Jesus.
Right.
It has to be able to please God, because if it don't please God, ain't no power going with it no way.
Because
that means God ain't in it.
Amen.
God ain't in it. That's just you doing that. God ain't got no, he ain't even got no desires in that. When we obtain favor from God, we automatically obtain favor with man. Here's some of the promises now that I know you already know, but they line up with the lifestyle in him that pleases him. Exodus 14 and 4 says, "The Lord will fight for you. You need not only to do nothing but be still." How simple is that? Exodus 14 and 14. How many times, I'm going to have to break away from that just a second. How many times have we been in position, in oppositions, and we've had to defend ourselves, but we didn't just stand still.
Amen.
And let God do it.
Amen.
And that's whether it be sickness or whether it be people or whether it be your flesh beating you up.
Mm-hmm.
God is just saying, stand still. He said, I'll fight for you.
Mm-hmm.
Just be still. All you got to do is just stand still. I'll fight. He done already told us in other scriptures, vengeance is mine, said the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So if anybody wronged you, I got that too.
Mm-hmm.
He already told you, whatever trap they set for you, he said, I said, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper.
Mm-hmm.
And even when they run in their mouths about you trying to run you down, he said, I'll condemn that too.
Mm-hmm.
God, I love you, Jesus. Mm-hmm. These are some of the promises of God to us. That a lifestyle in him that will please him. Exodus 20 and 12 tells us, even as young children, honor your fathers and your mothers. Honor them, that your days may be long on this earth. Honor them. And then we wonder how come so many people died, they say, of a, how they said it, died too soon. Man, I'm checking in what they was doing. What did they have in their heart? See, that's one thing about God. See, the secret things belong to Him. So we don't know everything about our children. We don't know everything about our family members. We really don't.
Amen.
But God does. God does. And if God sees that that family member is going to be a hindrance to you, His will in you, God's going to move them out the way. He sure will. He'll move. Lord. You better not act like you want to serve God in spirit and in truth. Isaiah 40:29 says, He gives strength to the weary and increase the power of the weak.
Yes, Lord.
The Bible says, let the weak say that I'm strong. His word covers us in every area of living on this earth in Him. If you need strength, all you have to do is ask Him for it, because see, His joy is strength. Isn't that something? He said that the joy of the Lord is our strength.
That's right.
Not happy because I want something. That ain't going to give you no strength. That's only temporary. It's just like a sparkle. It's going to spill out real soon. Especially if you went in money and you realize you got to spend it on something. That is, that thing gone. But the thing is, the joy of the Lord is our strength. What does that mean? Whether I got money or not.
Yes.
I'm full of joy.
Yes.
You can cash me in and give a return because I'm full of joy. Oh yeah. I can call down heaven to do whatever it is I need,
yes,
because
God.
I got joy.
Yes, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Living a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. Isaiah 40:31 says, they that wait upon the Lord, that little four-letter word be heard, folks. Those that wait upon the Lord, he said, He shall renew your strength. Whatever you've gone through for the Lord, amen, or even to get to the Lord, He promises, I'm going to renew your strength. He said, they that wait on the Lord, He said, He shall renew their strength. He said, then I'm going to do better than that. I'm going to mount you up like wings of an eagle, and you're going to begin to soar.
Jesus.
Ooh, shed that rub on our top. You're going to begin to just soar above your troubles. Because you know the eagle, what he does, right? When he sees trouble come, it says lock his wings in, and he goes above that thing. And see, we as believers, when we see the enemy of our flesh try to come at us, and then took a little team and gathered them with him. Oh yeah, oh he'll do that too. Your flesh will deceive you, I'm going to tell you now. Oh yeah. And then they give them a little team and drag them up with you to be ready to take you out. And if you got that spirit of an eagle, that faith of an eagle, because see, an eagle got faith. And he knows exactly, he can see the storm afar off. He can see it long before it come upon him. Oh, you got to have some serious spiritual discernment for that.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. To be able to see that storm, to see that test, to see that trial coming. Lock your wings. And begin to take that word and get yourself into Psalms 91:1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadows of the Almighty. And I guarantee you ain't no devil in hell coming there to get you. Can't nothing get you up in there. Because if they do, guess who they got to contend with? God Himself.
Yes.
You bad. Let me see you jump all on my father now. Oh, and I'm talking about my heavenly father.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Sister Lisa, that's what I had to tell my circumstance a couple years ago. You bad. Let me see how much you going to beat God, though. Because all I'm going to do is stand still.
Amen.
All I'm going to do is just stand. Because, see, your circumstances want to take you out. Your sicknesses and your unbelief and your doubt and everybody that you're dealing with is carrying that same thing, want to take you out.
Amen.
Because see, they see potential in you. They're like, oh, she could be a problem, though. Because she talking about every time you turn around, she's talking about God this and God that. Jesus said this and Jesus said, oh, we're going to have to take her out.
Amen.
Because she is a hindrance to our belief. She's a hindrance to what we want to do in our flesh. Oh, yeah. You better know you got the Lord and be ready to stand still and tell Him, Lord, this thing coming at me and it's coming at me like a Mack truck. I need you to strengthen me to stand. So see, the Bible teaches us in one of the scriptures in there, it tells you, don't try to avoid wrath. Let wrath come.
Mm-hmm.
It tells us, let them come. Let them bring what they got.
Amen.
Because they're going to see me. Remember in one of the stories here with Ezekiel, he told his servant, he said, Lord, open up his eyes that he may see who's with us. Because he was scared. They was getting scared of the people that was coming up against them. And all he did was just said, Lord, open up his eyes so he can see. A lifestyle to give us that same power to say, Lord, open up these eyes so they can see who's with me.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. When you're walking along at night or when you hear something, you home by yourself, Lord, open up whoever eyes out there so they can see
Jesus.
Who's guarding this house.
Ooh, glory
God. God, I love you, Jesus. Amen. Open up their eyes so they can see that they're not coming in here and going out of here with anything.
Amen.
Because of who's hovering over this place.
My Lord.
Mm-hmm. Isaiah 43:2 says, when you go through the waters, he says, I'll be with you.
Yes.
I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what it is. He said, I'm with you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. See, the problem is when God is saying, I'm not with you. That's where the problem comes in.
Amen.
If he says, I'm not with you, then you do have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
But said, when you pass through the fire,
Jeez.
He said, you won't even be burned. You won't even be kindled. You won't even come out that thing smelling like you've been in fire. Why? Because I'm with you. I'm trying to tell you, this is the lifestyle that we as leaders, laymen, as believers are supposed to be living in him so that we can do the will of God in peace.
Jesus.
We can do what God has called us to do. Why? Because that great big God that I'm pleasing with the lifestyle called holiness and righteousness and peace that I'm living in him in the Holy Ghost is protecting me.
Amen.
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 And to be honest with you, he'll also talk to time. He'll tell time they belong to God.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Time has to back up off of you, too. Mm-hmm. You've seen how people just age, but that's their activities that make them age like that. That's sin. That thing called sin.
Mm-hmm.
Sin will eat you up, girl, I'm telling you. Because, see, and the cute part about sin ain't going to eat your soul. It'll send your soul to hell.
Mm-hmm.
But it'll eat this flesh up. Sin is just like the worms that we already have in here that don't come out till we die. That's what sin is like while you're alive. It eats at this flesh, but it don't tell you that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's going to make them women, them young girls out there to think they hot and everything. And talking about, come on and get it. They're going to make them think that power of light going to run for, going to burn forever. And when God pull that little wick up out of you, you done.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. You just got to make it plain. Same with the men. When God pull that little wick out of there that causes you to burn, you done.
Amen.
Jesus.
It ain't a medicine on the face of this earth gonna jumpstart you. It's gonna kill you is what it's gonna do. Because you're trying to alter what God has already ordained.
All right.
You can't change what God. If God pulls that wick out, you better let it go and give thanks to it and leave it at that. Then I'll be running to mankind. I can't do this no more like I used to. I need to do this. Oh, well, let me write you out a prescription. That thing really saying death is what it's saying.
That's it.
He just wrote you out a prescription called death.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Why? Because, see, if you have a disability and you need God to come there and recharge you, charge up that member that's done got weak.
Amen.
Charge up that member that's done decided it want to sleep now for the rest of your life. God will do that. He really will.
Yes.
And he's only going to do it in a manner, in an area that's right now.
Amen.
And I'm talking about with husbands and wives. I ain't talking about boyfriends and girlfriends. I'm talking about husbands and wives.
Because
he instituted marriage, so he honors marriage.
Amen.
So that's what he does. Okay? I ain't talking about no girlfriend, because see, that's what's wrong with a lot of folks nowadays. They prostitute that which God gave them.
Mm-hmm.
Get out there now and sell it and stuff. And then when their little stuff stop working for them and stuff, then they're ready. Well, I'm going to church today.
Amen.
And I ain't got no more. Basically, they say, ain't no more fire in me. But out there, I'm dead now, so let me come on in here now and just... Yes. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Amen. Amen. That flesh sitting there beating the hell out of them, telling you, don't you remember when you was able to do this? And you can, yes! You giving that a bigger yes than anything. I'm telling you, we need deliverance. That's why we need deliverance. Because you cannot, when a lot of people come into the house of prayer, they're coming in because they have failed so much out here in this world. And they've lost a lot of things, they said, supposedly. And they can't do it no more. So then the next place, best place is the church. Oh, now I'm ready to serve God. Here I come, Jesus. All broke all up and beat all up, can't stand up, can't do nothing. And then you did it. Okay, I'm going to have to get off that. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to have to get up off that. I mean, the Bible teaches us to serve Him while you're in your youth. Serve Him in your youth. Don't go give Him no broken down, no broke down vessel and stuff. I'm going to use me, Lord.
Help me,
Father. Thank you, Lord. Isaiah 54:17 says, no weapon that is formed against thee. The Lord gave me a revelation of that thing a couple of years ago, Sister Lisa, when all that hell was going on in my life and that devil thought he had me. He said, no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. And then get this, and then he let me see that every time the enemy forms a weapon, tries to form a weapon to prosper in your life, that weapon got my name on it. But see, I serve a God that can turn that weapon around. And guess where the weapon go? The weapon ain't just roaming around out there because it didn't get me. It's going back to its originator. That weapon turns around by the hand of God, and they have to reap what they done sowed. That's what it's called. That's what it's called, reaping what they sow. But that same weapon that you set up for me, it coming right back to you. As my mom and me always used to say, you dig a ditch for me, you might as well dig one next to it, because you going down too.
Amen.
Oh yeah.
Amen.
So no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. Amen.
Amen.
I'm telling you, we've got to take God at His word. Believe the word, because the word is right. The word is true. And God honors His word in faith.
Yes, yes.
He only moves on our behalf in faith. He has to be able to see the faith. He can see His word, but He needs to see the charger of that word, which is faith.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Our God can do anything. He can do all things.
Yes, yes.
And then it says in Isaiah 54:17, it says, this is the heritage. This is our heritage. This ain't nothing we done accidentally fell upon. This is something God says, I've already ordained it for you. It's in your DNA to have. If we don't want it, we just don't get it.
Amen.
Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans. I know the plans that I have for you, said the Lord. He said, thoughts of peace and not evil. You got so many bitter believers walking around here. I mean, they angry. Mad. I wonder why. Because they thought they knew the plans, I guess. They didn't know. God do know the plans.
Amen.
Why? Because, well, I didn't get famous like that prophet told me. I didn't get a chance. I'm trying to make my way up here to TBNN and BET and Oprah and all them and get on these here shows and stuff. And they just done lied. Okay, I'm gonna pay my way. I'm gonna get my own self up there. I'm gonna make up a lying testimony that I know it'd be good, and they'll want to air it on the air.
Amen. That's what they do.
I know they do. All them lies they tell, just so they can get their names up, and then they can get on there. Bah, 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 bah. Oh yes, and the Lord said. Okay. Okay. All of that, just to get your name, to get your ambitious self up in somebody's face, so you can say, and then you might say, oh, well, thank the Lord did it. And that's where you run into that same area that Lucifer was in, that pride and stuff, and God ain't pleased with that.
Amen.
A lifestyle that doesn't govern the word of God and His sovereignty will not get the promises of God.
Amen.
It will not. See, we need, we was talking about this also in Sunday school. We need to realize God honors his word and hastens to perform it. He honors his word above all things and everything. He's not cutting no short corners here.
Amen.
He's not compromising. He ain't going by the, oh, I just didn't feel it today, Lord. Or, Lord, you know my heart. He ain't going by all that. He's going by his word. And if you stand on that word, the word will do what it's supposed to do.
Amen.
That word will unction you. It will give you the power and the strength to live holy, to do what God is saying. It'll give you the strength. Because see, Evangelist Brown, we miss a lot because, see, we won't trust the word to the point to know that I'm healed.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say I'm healed, the power is in your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
That's why God gave the word to you. A lot of times, like I'm sharing with them again, a lot of people think that God is going to get up off of his throne and come and take your hand and say, now you healed. No, he's not.
Jesus.
He wants you to take his word, and his word is going to heal you. Why? Because he's in his word.
Yes.
He's already spoken his word. His word does what he said. All you got to do is speak the word with faith. Yes. You don't have to separate God from his word and God sitting here and Jesus sitting over there and everywhere. Uh-uh, they all are one anyway. Mm-hmm. One don't move without the other.
Amen.
But see, we got to get our minds right, the perspective, the concepts in our mind. We're dealing with God.
Mm-hmm.
Well, who is God? He the one that says in the beginning was the word.
Mm-hmm.
And the word was with God and the word was God. He's the one that said in the beginning, let there be. That God. He's the one that separated the heavens from the earth, the firmaments and water. Because you know, it ain't nothing but water. We're walking around in no water.
That's right.
Show you how great he is. You didn't even know you was in water.
Jesus.
You didn't know you didn't need no goggles.
Mm.
But you're walking in water.
Amen.
You're still in water,
that's
yeah.
Right.
There's more water down here than it is above you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but God has a way. See yourself in a pool.
Uh-huh.
God has a way for you not to even know that you're walking in water.
Mm.
That you're breathing in water. Why? Because he fixed that thing when he separated the heavens from the earth. But it's still water down here. It's still water here. And I tell you, and I'm going to say this, I'm going to throw this out. I know you're going to think I'm crazy anyway, but it's okay. I'm already convinced that I'm not. But the thing is, when your eyes get cloudy and stuff, okay, and they get real watery, think about it. When your eyes, like if your sinuses bother you, and you always, you have people always say, well, everything looks so dim and stuff like that. It's just like walking in water.
Amen.
It's just like being in water when your eyes do that. Well, you in water, but it don't affect us like we are really in the water.
Amen.
Because see, what God did was a spiritual thing.
Mm.
That's why I said we got to come out of this here understanding in the natural and get into the spirit realm to understand what all he really has done for us. I'm telling you, we don't even drown. Waking up in water, sleeping in water, and I ain't even joking on it. Okay. All right. These promises of God do not govern the flesh. And see, again, as we said in Bible study, your flesh will take you to hell and won't even tell you. That's your ticket to hell.
Amen.
And it's one way. That's right. This here is your ticket to hell. And how is it to hell? Because it's never going to be saved. It can't get saved. It hates God. Why wouldn't it take you to hell? If it hates God. If it hates the one that you're saying you love, and it's saying, well, I hate it. Then you're going to hell.
Mm.
If you let that take you there like that.
Jesus.
I'm telling you, girl, this flesh is terrible. And we spend so much time on it. We want to make that all over and stuff like that. Okay, give me about 10 more minutes, okay? About 10 more minutes. I don't usually like to do that because I know where I am. Anyway. So now, in this lifestyle, you got the fruit of the spirit and you got the fruit of the flesh. Okay? Now you try to understand what I'm saying. The fruit of the flesh is divine displeasure to God. It's Galatians 5 and 17, 19 through 21. The works of the flesh. It's 17 of them.
Amen.
And it's in every one of us. Mm-hmm. Ain't none of us cuteness or nothing took them 17 works out. Every one of us got it in us.
Amen.
We have the ability to commit adultery. It's in here. Mm-hmm. We have the ability to fornicate. It's in here. We have the ability to be drunk, to party, spirit. It's in here. Mm-hmm. We got the ability to be perverted. It's in here.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends upon your habits and what the enemy knows that you used to like as an old creature.
Mm-hmm.
See, those things, you'd be surprised the lifestyle that we led us into some things.
Mm-hmm.
Because being saved, now you have to wonder, Lord, have mercy, I thank you. You must have been with me to keep me out of there.
Amen.
Because I was headed up a wrong road.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So the flesh, yours and mine, is divine displeasure to God. The flesh has no place in the new salvation, in the new life. There's no place for this. Sorry to tell you, I know that's bad news right there, but there's no place for it. So after we confess and live a new life, this dies every day. That's what it does. But guess what? It don't make you look like you're dying, okay?
Mm.
It's dying, but you don't look like you're dying. Okay, so you won't think that, okay, well, I'm going to need to put my makeup on and stuff. I'm going to be mortifying my flesh every day. No, not necessarily. Because, see, the flesh don't exemplify that type of death.
Amen.
Okay, it only exemplifies the death of sin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, not the fact that the Spirit of God is mortifying. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, amen. So, what is the fruit of the flesh? We just told you, Galatians 5 and 19 through 21. I'm not going to go through those because I know you know what they are, okay? And you can study them again. But we said that why do you put so much emphasis on the flesh and in the flesh? The flesh is not a fruit that God will honor.
My Lord.
God does not honor none of the fruit of the flesh. Think about it. It hates God. So why would the fruit from it honor God? It's not going to do it. It will never produce a fruit of God's acceptance, to God's acceptance. God will never take nothing that you got from here, you apply from this and pull from this and offer it up to him. It's not going to work. The flesh will only produce what it pleases, what appetites it has. Well, I feel like I want to whore around today. It's getting ready to produce something when it do that.
Mm.
Amen. Child, I saw that man. That man was so fine. Ain't gonna even say, well, if I'm married, if I hadn't been married, girl. But you're still lusting over the man. You're lusting. That's just like you ain't married.
Amen.
But that's a fruit of the flesh. That's what the flesh produces. Flesh only pleases flesh. And the fruit of it will never glorify God nor his word.
Mm.
Okay? Flesh cannot get into the presence of God. You'll never be able to usher your spirit or your soul into the presence of God by way of this.
Mm.
It don't work like that.
Because
mm-hmm. God is a spirit. God only deals with the spirit part of man. The spirit part of us is soul and spirit, not flesh.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. So the fruit of the flesh cannot live a lifestyle of holiness. That which God requires. As he told us, be holy. So the flesh is not going to produce nothing about peace. The flesh loves hell. The flesh loves drama. The flesh loves stuff to always be going on and get mad. Flesh loves that stuff. It don't want to be happy and rejoicing in the Lord because that's going to make it saved. Get saved. And it don't want to be saved.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. So 1 Corinthians 15 and 50 says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither do corruption inherit incorruption. So it's not going to work. Romans 8 and 8 says, so then, that they that are in the flesh cannot please God.
Mm-hmm.
So I have another scripture here. That's Ephesians 5 and 1 through 7. Study that, okay? Flesh cannot fellowship with the spirit of man. That's why you have so many different denominations, because of the fact that they can't fellowship with one another. Because, see, it's denomination that dilutes Jesus. Amen. The denominations is what dilute him.
Amen.
When you say, well, I'm Baptist and I'm Catholic, every one of them, I'm Jehovah's Witness, I'm Muslim, I'm Mormon, every one of them got a piece of Jesus that they done pulled out. Some say he's just a prophet. Some say, oh, he ain't the Son of God, and we don't believe in no after death and all that, the resurrection and all that kind of stuff. Uh-uh. And some say, oh, well, John Smith is the one.
Mm-hmm.
He the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
John Smith overrides Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's why I said denominations dilute Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I thank God the Lord just gave us to be non-denominational. We ain't none of them. We just call on the name of Jesus and believe God.
Thank you.
Amen. So fellowship in the spirit, in truth, spirit in the spirit, and in truth will mortify the flesh man. When you praise God, in other words, evangelists, when you begin to praise God, you telling your flesh, I don't believe no report you got. You telling your flesh, there's nothing you can make me believe that my God has not already done. That's what you're telling your flesh when you begin to praise God. Amen? Mm. The word of God will crucify it anyway. That's why people stay away from this here only on Sundays.
Mm.
Because they just want a partial death. They don't want a seventh day or week death.
Right.
The struggle is real. The struggle with the habits and the practices of the flesh is real. But the word of God is the overcomer.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. The word will give you the deliverance. It will conquer your flesh. Why? Because God created it, and God ain't created nothing that will overpower him.
Right.
Not nothing. Mm-hmm. I don't care how many times you talk, well, I don't feel like I want her. I don't want her no more. It don't matter. You can't overpower God. God's word is going to be no matter what. You can't stop God's word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may go through some things trying to stop it, but you won't stop Amen. God's word, Amen. Not his order. Now, the fruit of the Spirit, let me get to that. We know what the fruit of the Spirit is, right? Galatians 5 and 22 through 24. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. And the Bible says, against such there is no law. In other words, the word is saying against these nine words that are nothing but spirit and I govern them, can't no law come against them. Can't nothing stop these words. If these words reside in you, you better know heaven is walking with you also. You better know the host is guiding and leading you because of the words right there.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. And your flesh dies. The more you penetrate and activate those nine gifts, nine fruit, not the gifts, but the nine fruit of the Spirit, everything about you got to die in the natural.
Right.
If sickness is on board, everything got to shrink, swell up, dry up, all that kind of stuff. Why? Because you got the fruit of the Spirit, which is holy. This stuff is holy. And see, you can't have the fruit of the Spirit and not be walking in holiness. There's no way. There's no way.
Amen.
I'm not trying to get too excited.
Jesus.
I love this word, I tell you.
Mm-hmm.
And then verse 24 of Galatians 5 says, and they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its affections and its lusts. Them nine words is just like a machine gun coming from heaven. And I tell you, God will take down everything. Those words will come together and they begin to mount up and band like a fort around you. And everything that tries to come in from this shelter here, this flesh, those words will take them down. It takes it down every time.
Mm.
But you got to have faith to believe that. You got to have faith to know that God's word is more powerful than your will of your flesh. You got to know that. Because see, these words, God don't give us these words. He said that his words is life. He said they're spirit and they're life. And when he's speaking, he speaks life into your situation. He's speaking life into you every time the word of God is spoken.
Jesus.
So, I'm at the end here. Here's my testimony. The reason we gave out this subject here today, living a lifestyle that will activate the promises of God. And it brought, God brought back to my remembrance when he told me, he said that your children, he said, I've given your children eternal life. He told me that back in, I think it was in 2000, it was about 2000. I was on my way to work one morning. I managed properties then in the Section 8 program. I used to manage properties. I was the budget analyst. I recertified. I was the occupancy specialist. I did all that kind of stuff for over 21 years. But what I'm saying is that I heard him when he said that to me one morning. I was driving. He said, I've given your children eternal life. Now, there ain't nothing you can do with that.
Amen.
I began to cry and thank God for that. But now just the other day, he allowed me to understand what that meant.
Amen.
He said, you don't have to pray to me about your children.
Lord.
You ain't got to be constantly telling my Lord, remember my child. Because he told me over 10 years ago, he said, I've given your children eternal life.
Lord.
So in other words, whatever hell they choose to go through on this earth, they already got eternal life. Because that means at some point or another, in all that hell, they're going to say, Lord, save
yes,
me.
Yes,
they're going to say, Lord,
yes,
give me, help me.
Yes.
They're going to call on him. And God knows that.
Amen.
Isn't that something? He says, I've given them eternal life. All you got to do now is live a lifestyle that portrays holiness and righteousness. You ain't got to be all in, well, I got to pray for my children, sending these notes up and telling people, pray for my children. I don't think the last time I prayed for my children was the first time I prayed for them.
Amen.
That's right. That was the last time. Because I believe God for my children.
Mm-hmm.
And what else did that do for me? It set me free.
Mm-hmm.
It freed me. Freed me to do what? So I can run my mouth all I want to about Jesus. So God can use me at any point in time he sees fit. Why? Because I don't have no hindrances. Because he says, I've given your children eternal life.
Jesus.
And he told me in 2004, July, after that, he told me, he said, you've shown your children that their foundation must be Jesus. He said, now just live the life. That's all I have to do. I don't have to correct them. They can get nasty when they want to. I don't have to say nothing to them. First thing they said, we don't want mama to come. We don't want to talk to mama.
Amen.
But then again, they have to talk to mama.
Amen. Truly.
Why? Because see, I live a lifestyle that orders, it commands holiness. I live a lifestyle that the Lord himself says, I'm standing up on my throne and I'm honoring the life that you're living in the earth. So in order to activate the promises of God, which is the word of God, we've got to live a lifestyle that will activate God and his word.
Jesus, Jesus.
That will activate the team of God to come on our behalf. He said, there's no good thing will I withhold from you.
Mm.
Whatever you ask him for,
Jesus,
is automatic.
Yes.
And sometimes you don't even have to ask. He can see it already and he just puts it in your path to be able to just walk into it. Why? Because I'm living a lifestyle. We got to live a lifestyle. See, tradition and religion don't get it.
That's right.
Having a form of godliness from just dressing a certain way on the outward man and my heart is dirty don't get it.
Uh-huh.
We got to be able to be sanctified in this God that we serve. Because see, he promises to sanctify us, to deliver us, and to make us holy. He promises to do that in his word. And guess what? And he's the one that does all of that. All I got to do is believe.
Amen.
Isn't that something? All we got to do is believe God. So live a life, I say today, live a life where you will activate the promises of God. Whether it be healing, whether it be finances, whatever the case may be. But don't ask God for nothing out of greed and prideful acts and being in vain. Because God don't move off of that. He don't do nothing off of that. But the thing is, when he see the need in your life and the need of your desire is lining up with his desire and his plan for you, he automatically does what he needs to do. He will set the course for your lifestyle.
Amen.
He'll set the course for your way of dress. He'll set the course for the way you wear your hair and all that kind of stuff. He does that. A lot of people, they spend too much time trying to do God's job. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm not trying to get into that area, Sister Lisa, about the way I'm dressed, but I can say this. If I put on something that's inappropriate, the Spirit of the Lord will quicken me and tell me, don't put that on. Don't wear that out there. Why? Because I live a lifestyle that I depend upon Him to correct me. Amen. To tell me when I'm wrong.
Jesus.
Tell me what it is that displeases you. Because if it displeases you, it ought to displease me too.
Amen.
Remember Job, he lived a life. God bragged on him and said he lived a life that was upright. Amen. And he skewed. Skewed means that he hates it. He hates evil just like God hates it. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
So if we can't hate evil like God hated, we still got a ways to go. Amen. We still got a ways to go. But as long as you're on the path of getting there, that's the point.
Amen.
Get on the path of righteousness to get there to do it God's way. Amen.
Well,
we pray that and hope and pray that God has, through us, has said something, amen, to your hearing that will enlighten you for the rest of this day, as well as any other day that He permits for you until He brings you back to the house of prayer again, and He give us another word, because His word is our daily bread.
Yes,
amen. And this is what takes us through the day. Like I said, He gives us the word here, and I'm not bragging. This is just fact. Like Will, the guns of Will son, and he said, no brag, just fact. Amen. This is a fact. That the fact is that the word He gives us guarantees us that we will hear Him say, "Well done."
Jesus.
And I tell you, I don't believe no otherwise. I believe that when people come in here, God will heal and deliver them. Ooh. From whatever it is, set them free from whatever it is they're going through. Why? Because we've lived a lifestyle that will cause God to move on the behalf of His people.
Amen.
We love you all. Amen. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank and praise you today for what you've already said and done on our behalf. Now, Lord God, we just said, move by your Spirit. Let your will be done. Hallelujah to God. Show us now, Lord God, if we veered from the path of righteousness, set us back on the path of righteousness through the word of God, being the lamp unto our feet that will guide and lead us back into your path of righteousness in the name of Jesus. And Lord God, if we're on that path, keep us encouraged, oh God. Keep us, oh God, mindful of the things of God. Keep us, oh God, that we will keep our mind stayed on you, oh God, as you keep us in that perfect peace, oh God. Because we trust you, Lord God. We honor you because you are our God in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord God, we ask in the name of Jesus that as you take my sister, oh God, for another report, God, we said, make them out of a liar this time.
Yes, God.
We say, Lord God, close the book on this case.
In the name of
God, in the old song time. We said, Lord God, be there.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
God. Oh, God. Yes. Be there, Lord God, and do what you need to do. Because, see, we've heard their report, but the final report is you. God, you are the final answer to her case. You are the final answer for her case. We thank and praise you, oh God, for everything that she stands for in you. And we thank and praise you that even this experience, oh God, is going to cause her faith now to escalate even more in you. In the name of Jesus. God, bless us, your people. Bless we, your people. Bless us, oh God, as only you can bless us. In the name of Jesus. And we'll be so ever.